Hello everyone and welcome to this week's episode of Shadowrun. I hope everybody can hear me. Can you just test your mics, guys?
Testing.
Yeah, absolutely fine.
Testing.
Excellent. Yeah. Oh dear, we're a bit short of the on the ground today. We've had some good news. Well, I've got some bad news, some sad news, some bad news, and some good news in that order. So the sad news is that Medivac, who normally plays Locke, I got a message from him this morning saying that he no longer wants to play, so he's not around tonight. So that's the sad news. The bad news is I knew that Locke wanted to buy some. Oh, my box is really weird. Oh, that's better. I knew that Locke wanted to buy an agent for his decking, and which couldn't actually be got by the fixer. So I'd actually created the next adventure to sort of like go back and infiltrate Qubit 64 to try to get the agent program. So the whole adventure that I created was sort of like based on Locke, sort of like developing his character. So, but now he's no longer here. I sort of like feel, well, it'd be a pretty boring adventure if everybody's just following Locke around. So I've had to come up with a new idea off the cuff throughout the day to sort of like pull something together. Unfortunately, and we don't know why, Billy Bob, Big Beastie, who plays Billy Bob, isn't here. We haven't heard from him, so we assume that he's either running late or he's actually gone off with Medivac somewhere, and it's a conspiracy theory and they're off together, you know, on a romantic date, or I don't know what's going on. So anyway, we, not to be put off, we have still decided to go ahead and play, and because I've spent every 5 minutes I've had today, spare 5 minutes as well as working, trying to make up an adventure. So we're going to go for it because I don't want to waste it. So we'll start off by letting the players introduce the characters who are here, and then we can go from there. And we'll start with somebody who looks like he's asleep, which is Chugga Wugga. Oh, he's woken up.
I was messaging Big on Twitter to see what it was.
All right, cool. Thank you.
Hi guys, I'm Chugga. I play the team's combat mage. He goes by the name of Stanley Lovely. His street name is Studley. He specializes in combat magic. He's middle-aged, receding hair, slightly overweight, very overweight, which Tornado realized last adventure when he tried to pick him up when
he certainly did.
When Studley was actually unconscious. When he's not throwing spells and being the face of the team, Studley lives at home with his mom, where he looks after her and cares for her in her late years.
Bless her.
And I will just, who shall I pass on to?
Oh, I don't know. There's so many options.
I'll pass on to Inwards. No, Longshanks, EPG.
Thanks, Chugga. Hi guys, I'm Longshanks CPG. Tonight I'm playing Tornado. He is the group's driver, chauffeur, and rigger. So he has a whole load of drones which he can sort of like transfer his mind into. So he can either transfer his mind into them and fly them as the drone, or he can fly them through AR, which is AR. He can either fly them through VR or through remote control. So he sort of like provides the group overwatch, sort of like, and can do close combat support with some of his drones as well if needed, as well as being the getaway driver. And I'll pass it on to our GM in Wales.
Excellent. So we're going to start off today's session just sort of like making sure that everybody has everything that they wanted to buy from last week's end session, because last week the run came to an end and you were duly paid and you also got some karma as well. So is there anything that anybody would like to spend their karma on, or anything that you would like to purchase? You do have two NPCs who can actually help you with that. You've got Cookie, who's your fixer, You've also got a talismonger to help Studley called Mistletoe. Anything that's actually available below sort of like availability 10 that is not restricted or forbidden, then that's absolutely fine. You can purchase that. It's whether or not you need anything more substantial. So does anybody, first of all, does anybody want to spend any karma? That's the first question.
No. Well, my karma spending depends on whether or not I can get hold of certain items.
Cool.
Because I was looking at approaching Mistletoe and to see whether or not he can get me a spell focus.
Okay, then. So what spell focus are you planning on buying?
I need a rating 3 spell focus, which is a sustaining one, which is categorized for health spells.
Okay, and what's
the availability of that is 9R.
With
the base cost of 12,000.
With 12,000. Okay, then. So, Mistletoe can roll his negotiation and plus his charisma. So he actually has a negotiation of 6 plus his charisma of 4, which means he'll be rolling 10 dice. His social limit is 7. So 7's the maximum, and the spell focus will be rolling 9 dice. Now, you can, if you wish, add additional money for him to have more dice, and every 25% of the total cost increases the dice roll by gives an extra dice to that roll. So for example, 25 would be 3,000. So if do you want to pay above and beyond 12?
I think for the actual cost of it, what it's going to be anyway, I can't really afford to put any more of a thing. So I would just have it at his standard.
Okay, so the what did he say? 9R. Okay.
9R.
So this is the
because that 12,000 would also have all the other people's charges on, won't it? For example, Cookie, Mistletoe's going to charge me for it.
Yeah.
Somebody's going to charge him for it. So chances are that 12,000 is going to jump up a fair bit anyway.
Yeah. But it's a basic price, so you can sort of add on 3,000 for it. Anyway, the 9d6s actually got 6 successes. So which I think you should, can you see that in the chat?
Yes,
well, 6 hits.
Yeah. So this will be this is negotiation plus charisma. So this will be 10 dice for 5 hits, which actually means that he can't actually get. Oh, he got 2 ones as well, which means that he can't actually get it this week. So unfortunately, you'll have to come back and ask him to re-roll it for you next week, unless you want to try to locate it yourself.
No, I shall.
Okay.
Yes.
Cool. Okay then. So, are you going to leave your karma then for next week as well?
Yeah, because I mean, I've got like 7 karma, but if I eventually manage to get one of these things, it's going to cost me 6 karma to actually bind it.
Cool.
So I do need him, if he's able to get hold of some spell reagents.
Yeah, that's absolutely fine. They're what's the availability of those?
They don't have an availability.
Oh, so that's fine then. So how many would you want?
I normally carry 12 with me. They're 20. Last time I got charged 12, well, first time I got them, 12 drams were 240. and the second time 6 drams were 300.
Okay, so Mistletoe's feeling a little bit disappointed that you know, he hasn't been able to get you the spell focus this time, so he's prepared to sort of like sell them to you at cost. So whatever you would normally pay for them, he will sell you.
So 20 each will be 240.
40, yeah, and that's because he feels a little bit disappointed that, you know, he hasn't been able to get your spell focus. But he does say, he does sort of like remind you to come back. Because, you know, he is keen to do business with you, you know, and then that's the important thing.
Okay. The other thing that I need to try to pick up, which will probably just be from the standard electrical store, is a subvocal microphone for my comm unit.
Yeah.
Which has an availability of 4 and a cost of 50.
Yeah, so you can, that's below the 10, so you could quite easily purchase that. That's not an issue. It's not restricted, so you could probably pick it up in any sort of like shack, you know, here, then, everywhere. So, yeah, just reduce your money.
Okay. And finally, I want to have a word with, is she called Ida?
Ida's your street doc, yeah.
Yeah, I want to see whether or not she can get hold of any trauma patches.
Yeah, cool.
So the trauma patch is availability 6. It's not restricted or anything, but the cost is 500 credits.
Each or in total?
Trauma patch is 500 each per patch.
Okay, then. So you've helped her out in the past, haven't you?
A couple of times.
And you helped her when she had the zombie problem, didn't you? So she's, what's a normal price? 500 a year. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, she, roll your negotiation, Studley.
I don't know, because I've got a couple of characters open.
I get one hit. Okay, you get 2, so she's willing to sort of like sell it for just 50% extra for what it is. So instead of 200, it'll just be 300 credits, and she's happy with that.
They're 500, so that's going to be 750.
I thought they were 200. 500, so she'll sell them. She wants to get about 100 credits profit on it. So that'll be, you'll sell them for 600, yeah.
Okay, so 1,200. Okay, and I think that is all I need.
Excellent. So all done and dusted then.
Yeah.
Yeah. Brilliant. So right. Well, let's get on with the adventure now. I have to say at this point, the whole last adventure was actually based on Locke's character, and he's not here. So I recreated the adventure tonight throughout the day, and I focused on Billy Bob to start it off. And now Billy Bob's not here. So it's just sort of like, I'm not too sure. So, well, what
I can do the Billy Bob bit.
Yeah, I think that's the thing, and each of you have got each of those characters.
Unless Longshanks wants to,
wants
to do it. Billy Bob's
you pretty. Billy Bob, I can kind of do an Irish accent to be sure. So I can kind of.
I don't know whether Billy or not we're doing who'd you call it as well, Locke.
Yeah, and Wills has mentioned that I'm going to be doing Locke.
Yeah,
you tell me what to roll and when.
Correct. So what it'll be will be I'll tell Tornado what to roll on Locke's character, if and when. And then Studley, if you do Billy Bob's, and then you've both got the extra two. And then we will see what happens as the session goes on. Okay, then. So, you finished the last job. There's because nobody, you're just buying some items. There's no length of time to actually wait. This next adventure can go consecutive to the next one. So we're only sort of like one quarter of the way through a monthly life style cost.
Tornado's
my
health issues.
Okay, so what is Tornado's health issues, health at the moment?
Well, at the end of the thing, so I'd done the whatchamacallit. So,
the end of the thing, you'd done the whatchamacallit.
So, at the end of the last, sorry, it's been a long day. At the end of the last session, at the end of the last run, Tornado just got out. He spent 2 days in hospital in the ICU. So, I can't remember, was that just one health?
I think that would have brought him back up to. I think at the end of the last adventure, you had one physical box filled in, which means that you could actually have left then.
We left it when he was 8 physical, so I think he got 2 boxes back.
Okay, then. So how many boxes do you still need?
I don't know, because I very helpfully cancelled it. So I'm just trying to think. So
So
8 boxes he needs to get back.
Okay, so roll your body twice as an extended test.
Roll body twice.
So each one of these is a day. So to repair physical damage, it's your body times 2 per day. So if we need 8. After 3 days, then the 8 will be recovered. So in those 3 days, that's absolutely fine, because Tornado wasn't doing anything like getting any more getting any more gear or anything like that. So that's absolutely fine. He's fine and he's underway. Okay, brilliant. So brilliant. Right, anything else that needs? So that'll still be, you'll be up to full now, and we're still to that that bit, and we still haven't finished off another week. So we'll start it at that week. Right, let me just see what view we're on. So let's change it to the nice small view, and then everybody can be seen. Okay, so... there's nothing, there are not many things in the world that is worse than a comlink call at about 8 o'clock in the morning. Well, maybe some nasty dreck coming in the form of slugs and spells, but hey, you know, being a runner or runners, you are quite used to that. Now, the comlink indicates an incoming call, and what makes it even worse is that it is the girlfriend, Billy Bob. Well, one of them. Anyway, after quickly trying to remember if it was your anniversary or not, and coming up with the answer, probably not, you answer the call, voice only. You know, nobody would like to see an orc first thing in the morning. And you notice that the incoming call is from Handbrake.
So, of course, Billy Bob's probably been on the... Been on the beer the night before, so 8 o'clock in the morning is not the best of times for him.
No, not at all.
He does see the comm call coming in, and those are his immediate thoughts. What has he forgotten? What was he supposed to have done? And he picks up the call, and he says.
That was funny, because you gradually went into his gruff voice as you came to the end of the sentence.
Hi, babes.
And she sort of like replies. She's still on voice only. She says, she's quite rough and ready, Handbrake. And she says, you need to do me a favour.
Well, you know me. And anything for you.
Well, you you know that Street Fighter I've been supporting. You know,
yes.
Yeah, remember his name?
No.
Bert the Basher.
Oh, Bert.
Yeah, you know, the Orc Street Fighter.
Yeah, Bert.
The one that we went and saw the other night. Well, I saw him. You spend a lot of the time at the bar, I think.
You know how it is, babes, with my with my job. I sometimes take hits to the head, you know, and the stuff that I remember.
Well,
is,
I've got a favour to ask you of you, Billy Bob. No, it's not that sort of favour.
Oh.
Something completely different. You know that, you know, Bert the Basher.
If I do that favour, would the other favour maybe on the table?
Well, it depends. It depends how well you do this.
Well, you know I miss you.
Yeah. So my comlink says, i.e. no calls over the past week.
Yeah. Bad interference.
Yeah.
That's, yeah. Anyway.
Anyway, Bert the Basher, the Orc Street Fighter. You know, he's actually earned me some cash recently. Well, he would have earned you some cash as well if you had followed my advice and actually betted on him. Anyway, he's doing pretty good. And as you know, he has a rather glowing personality as well. Well,
yeah, a bit like me.
Yeah, well, anyway, Bert, his last fight is in 2 weeks' time. But this is Monday morning, and he left on Friday from the training gym. And he hasn't turned back in this Monday for his morning session. And, you know, with a fight coming up, he's actually coming in 5 days a week, 9 o'clock to 4 o'clock every day, training. Anyway, I was talking to the manager when I was working out, and he's a bit worried. And I said that I knew a good people who could help out.
Cool, and you want me to get in touch with him?
Yeah, well, you know...
Oh, is it us?
It's all of you.
Oh, right.
And I'd like you. I've arranged for a meeting with you and your guys with Sid at Sid's training gym. It's called Sid's Stadium, but you already know that, don't you? Today, 10 o'clock.
What, in the morning?
Yeah, like in a few hours' time. Yeah, and I said you would do it, Billy Bob, if you get my drift.
Right, 10 o'clock.
Yeah, 10 o'clock. Bring your friends as well.
Sid's.
Yeah, Sid's Stadium. Okay then.
Bird.
Yeah, see you soon. Maybe. And she ends comlink.
So Billy Bob's going to put in a call to everybody else, explaining that he needs a favour to get back into the good books with one of his exes, and that it might also be a paying job, hopefully.
Yeah.
So yes, and he will. He will say that the meeting point is a gym in Southside called Sid Stadium.
Yeah,
and he will he'll say that he'll pick everybody up.
Yeah.
Well, I was about to say Tornado would have got the message and sent a message back to say each individually he'll say I'll be outside yours at whatever time to pick you up in time.
Okay.
So he'll go around with his van to pick everyone up and then drive us all off to Sid's.
Cool. Well, let me tell you a bit about sport in 2076, just so you get a complete understanding. So in 2076, in this 20th century, okay, it was all about figuring out how to turn professional sports into big business. Well, in the 21st century, it's all about how best to use sports business to benefit other corporate interests. So there's lots of sport still around. So you have basketball and baseball and football, as in American football, and soccer, English football, and hockey and ice hockey and everything like that. And they still draw massive crowds. But now fans, can follow their favorite players on Me Feed. And, you know, that's the sort of like the huge social media like Twitter that we have to get today and MeFeed. And they can watch the tridios that their sports personalities watch, and they can listen to the music that they listen to, and they can learn about their favorite fashions and foods, all which you can buy, of course, with a quick gesture at the right arrow. And then that's it. It's done. You know, where kids once dreamed of following their idols by working hard to earn their way, you know, into the big leagues to become stars in their own right, they're now content just to buy as much of their idol's lifestyle as possible. The megacorps have also been growing new sports that give consumers / fans the addictive rush of the fast-moving action and, of course, bone-crushing violence. Right now, the most popular new sports are urban brawl and combat biking. Now, urban brawl is a no-hands-barred variant of, like, capture the flag. And it's played in the city streets, and you use guns and magic. So
guns and magic.
Yes, it's no holes barred, very violent. People absolutely adore it. You know, combat biking is a bit like polo, you know, on the horses, only it's played on motorcycles and by psychopaths. So you can imagine the general disruption that happens there. But in Southside, where you're currently at the moment, although the violence is still present, there is something known as a fighting circuit. Now, these are a series of bare-knuckled, cyber-lacking punch-ups when brawny fighters punch, kick, bite, whatever they want until one gives up or goes down. And you don't need to pull punches or anything like that. If he goes down and he's unconscious, you win. If he goes down and he's dead or she's dead, fine, you win. And hopefully they'll have a street doc nearby to actually bring them around. This is where the money's made. So either in managing the fighters or being a punch bag. Oh, a fighter, sorry. It's up to you. Or betting strategically on the winners. Now, fighters are said to be honourable and dedicated. Sadly, only one of these attributes are shared by the managers themselves. Okay, so basically, in order to be on the street circuit, for the fighting circuit, sorry, you are not allowed to be cyber enhanced or drug enhanced. It is purely your own everyday punch up, and that's it. And if you don't have that, then typically, you can't be in the fighting circuit. Okay. Anybody got any questions about any of that?
What about being magically enhanced?
Hmm. Yeah. It's basically the fighter brawling is all about the rough and tough, brawny fighters. Hmm. You know, right. It's not about adepts. It's not about Ponzi magic. It's all about physical violence, you know.
Okay, so yeah. how legal is it underground or is it above ground, this type of fighting?
Yeah, nothing is completely legal, you know, in that sense. It does pull big crowds, and there tends to be certain areas, certain locations that these fights happen. And they tend to be advertised on, you know, certain social media sites that people frequent. Yes, the law enforcers could actually technically break it up if they wished. However, probably most of the officers have actually got bets on in any case. So with the law enforcers being a private company, they're not going to sink huge amounts of money in trying to locate and break up the fights. Plus, their bosses will probably be paying somebody to be the best fighter and have money heavily involved as well.
And we take it it's the latter of these three that... that Bert is in...
Bert the Basher, yeah. He's in the fighting circuit.
Okay, so after getting the call through from Billy Bob and getting the basic gist of the job from him, Studley's probably got sort of like an hour or so before Tornado is due to pick him up. So can he... can he have a look on the Matrix to see whether or not he can find out anything about both Bert the Basher? Well, he'd like to know, try to find out a bit more about Bert the Basher. He would also like to know who his manager currently is, if he can find that out, and he also wants to see whether or not he can. Find out anything about the next lot of fights that Bert's supposed to maybe
if you roll a Matrix search and Locke, can you roll a Matrix search as well? It should just be your computer plus logic, I think, or is it intuition?
Matrix search is computer plus logic.
Computer plus logic. So hang on, don't you roll yours yet, Studley. Okay, just leave it like that. Locke, roll yours as well. Three successes, yeah? So roll another three dice, Studley. Because we can team test it. Because the chances are both of you would find out information and then combine them when you meet up.
Why did that just roll one?
Because you put rolling one d6 greater than five. Let's roll another two.
It's rolled them. Nothing.
Oh, cool. Okay, then, so three successes. Okay, then, so list your questions and I'll answer them. So you got three successes, so you got three answers.
Okay, who is the manager of Bert?
Bert the Basher, is managed by Sib Gabetti, who is the owner of Sid Stadium.
Who is the next person that Bert is supposed to be fighting?
Yeah, so the next person he will be fighting in 2 weeks' time, 2 weeks from Friday. So it's not this Friday, it's the following Friday, will be Snapper Saul. They all have some really nice streetwise names. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
One more question.
Locke, any questions?
I'm just trying to think. Maybe. So we've got the manager.
Who's the managing team of Snapper Salt?
Yeah, he seems to be managed by somebody called Edwina Smith.
Oh, not Curry.
No.
You make that name up just then.
No?
No.
I was trying to find it on Realmworks.
Cool.
If there's time, Locke would also like to see if he can pull up the Bashers me feed to see what the last sort of like set of posts were on the me feed. Bert's posts were on me feed.
Yeah, so that would be part of the questioning on the matrix search. So
how can we, so looking at it, how far is Bert up on the circuit? I take it it's sort of like done for, you know, at the end of the circuit somebody is sort of like wins it, you know.
Yeah. Well,
Is he heading for a title fight?
Yeah, they don't tend to publicly broadcast that onto the Matrix. It's probably on some site somewhere, but whether or not you can actually locate it at the moment, you know, it's not going to be publicly out there. So you, in order to do that, you're going to have to do an extended search. If you want to gather and specific information about Bert the Basher or the fighting circuit. Alternatively, you could ask Sid when you arrive at the meet.
That's probably going to be the best way around it. So having found that information, Studley's going to wait until he's picked up.
Okay. So everybody gets picked up and you make your way to Sid Stadium. And Sid Stadium is like a one of these typical training gyms. You know, so there's sort of like some kind of a boxing ring, and then there's all these sort of like weightlifting and contraptions scattered all over the place. And you notice that when you get here at 10 o'clock in the morning, there's a lot of grunting and sweating and people in shorts and vest tops. And they all seem to have protective padding on at the moment, although you do know that actually in the real fights that there's no protective padding at all. There's a lot of people sort of like sparring with each other or skipping or bench pressing things. There seems to be the majority of the metahumans in this place appear to be either orcs or trolls. There doesn't seem to be very many humans at all. And the humans tend to be the people that are completely padded up and being used roughly as punch bags. You know, well, it seems that most of the fighters are either troll or orcs. There's no elves or dwarves in the place at all. You notice that over at the ring, there's two people sparring. And there seems to be a human that is just sort of like resting on the top of the ring, staring in to the into the ring and sort of like barking out instructions to people, you know, like left, right and center, and sort of like saying do this or do the other. I'll just see whether or not I think I've got a picture for you. If I downloaded it.
As Studley's getting out of his gets out the car, he's going to focus a magical spell through his focus concentration ability.
Cool.
And cast it through there, and then have that sustain it. So he's casting increased charisma 3, force rating 3, on him on himself.
Cool.
He gets 3 successes and resists the drain from it.
Excellent.
Charisma will now be 6.
I thought I had a picture for you, but
which I will put down as a modifier.
Cool. Let's see if I put it in maps, because when I was creating the venture, things went all over the place.
Has Billy Bob met Sid before?
No. Everybody's new to each other. All that Billy Bob knows is that he's been to a fight with Handbrake before.
And that poster at the back reminds me after an Indian.
What?
this one here.
I think I've got something open on top of it. Just one second, because I'm just trying to find.
I thought you meant that one.
Oh, I can't see what that one says.
I can't see what it says, but it's more just the.
Oh, right. No, this one.
I have some great.
Oh, yeah. I just read it.
Which one am I looking at?
The middle one at the back.
That one.
I can't read it. Was it something on fire?
Ring of Fire.
Oh, right. Ring of Fire. Get you. Right. Let's see if I can do this for you. I'm not going to be able to.
Don't worry too much, guys. It's only a picture.
No, but it might add. Right. I think I might have managed to do it. There you go.
So Tornado would have parked.
No, can't see a thing.
It's coming.
Yeah, to the, you know, right.
Is that a data jack in his head?
Yes, it is. That's what he looks like. So he's sort of like leaning on the ring, on the ropes, sort of like shouting out instructions to the participants. Of the match, and sort of like saying do this and do this, etc., etc.
Sorry, are we inside now?
Yeah.
So you hear, if you look over at Locke, he will be sort of squinty eyed and clenched jaws, and sort of like his fists will be sort of like doing this a little bit. He's looking around and says, "Oh, to be sure, there seems to be a lot of orcs and piles of rubble in here."
Hmm. Okay, cool. So what's the plan, guys?
Studley is going to make his way across the gymnasium floor, probably with Billy Bob sort of like hovering behind. And Studley's going to go to the other side of the ring and stand next to the guy, and you hear him cough, and he says, Mr. Gambetti, is it?
Sid sort of like, and Sid Gambetti sort of like turns around, and he sort of like pulls a huge drag on his cigar that he sort of like blows out over all four of you. And he sort of like turns and looks at you, and he looks some like puzzled, and he looks at you, Sterling, and he says, "Please do not tell me that you are here to join."
Studley takes his handkerchief out of his pocket and sort of like puts it over his nose to cover up the smell of the cigarette smoke, and he says, "My name is Stanley Lovely, and we are here on request of a friend of mine's ex-girlfriend, her name being Handbrake." And
Billy Bob taps you on the shoulder and says, "She's not ex, she is."
Oh, sorry. I thought you had had a disagreement. Concerning a fighter of yours who has not been seen for a few days.
Ah, you must be friends of Handbrake. Come into the office. Come into the office. Keep your guard up.
Yes.
And he sort of like takes you over to an office, and as you approach the door, there's quite a burly female orc that sort of like is clutching some kind of clipboard and a piece of paper, and she seems to have a headset off or some description. And Mr. Gambetti gets close, she sort of says, Mr. Gambetti, you need to not now, Cynthia, he says, and walks into his office, and she sort of like looks down at you as if to say, you know, who the hell are you guys? How come you've got priority over me?
Studley will walk in saying, as he passes good morning, Cynthia.
Yeah, and the room's very small. So the only people that can actually fit into it is Studley and Tornado. There's only two chairs in there. So Locke and Billy Bob actually wait outside and commune with the secretary outside. And the door's shut, and Sid sort of like sits down and takes another long puff of his cigar and blows sort of like thick smoke into the air. And he says, so you come to help me with my problem?
Yes, would you mind all three if I take notes?
Well, take whatever you want, as long as it's not money.
Thank you very much. And Studley will take out of, he'll unfold a bit of electronic paper and then get a stylus out of his top pocket.
Cool.
He's going to be watching Sid carefully through the as he's talking, just to see whether or not he can judge his intention, to see whether or not maybe he's might be.
Okay, so you
truth at all.
You tell me when you want to do the role, then. Yeah. If he said anything that you want to check, then let me know. But remember that every time you do it. You know, so it might be worth waiting to a certain moment. Okay, so Sid starts to detail you the sort of like what's involved, and he says, right, so it's quite simple, you see. I need you to find Bert for me. He should have been here at 9 o'clock this morning. He's never ever late, and he's gone missing, I think. He might just be at his apartment, but I need you to find him.
From my understanding, the last time he was seen was when he left the stadium. Was it last night or the night before?
Yeah, Friday night he left here.
Right.
After a really good fighting session, he's made me lots of cash, this fighter.
Right. Okay. And when he what you have his address, I presume. How far away is it from the stadium, and what routes does he normally take?
It's like a minute down.
Right. He probably walks then.
Yeah, he lives just above the delicatessens down the street.
Oh, right. Do they do nice pastries?
Bert's made me lots of money, and he's got one last fight left, and then that's it. He'll be off the circuit. He'll be able to live in the lap of luxury with the monies that he's made.
So a fairly big fight, then.
Right, it's just one more fight. One more fight for Bert.
Why only one more fight? If he's this good, will he not be returning for next season?
No, he's decided that one more fight and that's it. So, as the contract goes, last fight, you get your winnings.
Right.
Before then, you just get pocket money.
Right, okay. And who is this last fight against?
He sort of like points to a big burly sort of like troll. On the wall, and you notice that there's sort of like a picture of him like this, and with his tusks up and his horns and everything, and underneath it says Snapper Saul, and he says Snapper Saul.
Yes. So what are the odds on Bert?
actually winning the fight? Is he going in as favourite?
He'll win. Hasn't lost one yet.
Oh. And
plus, he's got a good manager and trainer.
Well, yes, I can probably yes. And when is the fight due to take place?
Like I said, 2 weeks on Friday.
2 weeks, right.
From last Friday. So not this Friday, but the Friday after.
2 weeks, yes. I have that now. Right. Yes, I think it's pretty straightforward. Is there anything else that you can tell us that might be of interest? What was his social life like, or was it all training? Does he have a lady friend?
He says, he looks at you and he says, I'm the trainer and manager. I don't get into any personal life stuff or that. They come here, I train them, they fight, they earn their money, they go home. Mm. Mister, always keep personal life separate from business. Business, pleasure. Keep them away from each other. The less I know, the better.
What about enemies on the circuit? Has he got any particular
He sort of like looks at you, Tornado, and says, he's one of the top fighters who doesn't have enemies.
Okay. Just out of interest, if Bert was not to turn up for the fight, injured or just didn't turn up, whatever, who stands to gain the most?
The most what?
The most money.
Wow.
Would another fighter...
Not him.
Would another fighter be put in for the prize fund?
No. Snapper Soul wins on default. A lot of people will lose a lot of money. And most importantly, so will Bert the Basher. Because he's missed a match and therefore he doesn't collect anything.
And unless, of course, somebody bets on that odds that he doesn't turn up.
Why would we bet on a fighter not turning up?
Well,
it's a fighter circuit.
Make sure he doesn't turn up, and then you make the winnings.
He sort of like leans forward from you, and he sort of like looks you up and down. He sort of like says, "You're not a fighter." He says, "In this world, you fight or you fight. Only pansies don't show up."
Yes, well, it's funny you should say that, but after I had finished my former career as an investigative journalist, one of the options that I did have open to me was, it wasn't going into fighting, to be honest with you. No.
So, are you going to fight Bert for me?
Well, we're going to do our utmost best to see whether or not we can locate him. This, of course, is being done as a favour to my friend's girlfriend, not ex-girlfriend.
No, don't go down there. I know that things like this cost money.
Well, I mean, everybody has expenses, as you will probably realise. We are, as you can probably tell, a highly trained group of individuals who are trained.
Let's make this interesting. Let's start off with a sum. And if you reach and actually... arrange and complete the job within that time, you collect. If not, the amount reduces per day.
Ah. Right. And what is the starting amount?
Oh, I am a manager. I'm not calling the shots here. You look like a betting sort of man. You do. Tell me, you're the experts, you're the professional players, you're the professional runners like you just mentioned. Tell me, what's your going rate?
Our standard rate per person is normally around the region of 3,000 credits.
Right. You're cheap.
No, that's per day.
Oh, per day?
Yes.
Per day. So 12,000 credits per day.
Yes.
Well, he says that's a bit. Okay, then he says, let's make this. How quick can you get the job done?
Well, have you provided us with all the information that you that you have? Is there anything else that you can think of that may help in us finding Bert? Any little detail? Any threats on his life? Has he received any messages?
He looks at you again and he says, I'm a manager and trainer. Business, personal. Keep it separate.
Right.
So how quick? It's Monday morning. How quick can you find him and get him back to my training gym?
We would hopefully have a update for you within 48 hours.
Define update. I need to know when you can get him back here, out there, in that ring training.
Well, that's hard to say. We can definitely, probably almost certainly, give you a... an update within 48 hours.
Okay. Since you're avoiding the question, let's say this.
And is
bye. If you get him here in that ring by 10 o'clock Thursday morning, I will give you and your party 20,000 credits.
Yes.
However, every day after that, we reduce it by 2,000.
And if we would get him there by Wednesday?
Ah, I see. Well, you con. Negotiation. Have you got your increased charisma on?
Yep.
Wow.
And I was pretty pleased with that roll.
Yeah. Are you using any edge?
No.
I was listening to Arcology about faces, and they were saying that the only role that faces should edge is their negotiation role.
Yeah, I appreciate that, but I think the other thing that we got to realise is that I'm very much a secondary face.
That's all right.
If you see what I mean, it's my main thing is the. Is my magic,
yeah.
And face was something I took on as a sort of like a secondary,
and that's absolutely fine. He says okay then. He says we'll make it easier. Get him here by Thursday 10 o'clock, 20,000. Get him here before that. Well, we'll give you an extra grand each.
Oh right, okay.
He got 2 successes, so you failed. Right.
That seems reasonable. Best get going then.
Yeah, and he said that's absolutely fine. And he sort of like says, he looks at his watch, his comlink, and sort of like looks down at it, and he says, see you on Thursday, 10 a.m. then.
Yes, or before.
So
the secretary outside, what race was she?
She was orc.
Orc.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. So as we're going out, Studley wants to see whether or not he can have a word with her.
Yeah, well, she's sort of like, she's quite busy. She seems to be trying to get Sid to sign things. What is it that you want to know from her?
I just want to know whether or not she knew anything about Sid's personal life.
Yeah, well, she sort of like looks at you and sort of like says, I'm sorry, I don't go into my manager's personal life at all. And she looks quite shocked.
Sorry, not
at you.
Not Sid's, Bert.
Well, make up your mind who you want to ask about. I don't know anything about Sid. I am a secretary, not his personal bit on the side. And what do you want to know about Bert? Please be quick. I am busy.
I just wanted to know.
She seems to be stacking papers. That's what she seems to be.
As you're probably aware, he has. He seems to have gone missing. I just wondered whether or not you knew who his friends were, or maybe whether or not he had a lady friend, or.
I'm a secretary here. I'm not his chaperone.
Well, yes, but.
He lives down the street with two other fighters.
Ah.
What about a locker? Does he have a locker here?
No, we don't. People come and fight. They don't bring valuables to this place.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Yes. Thank you very. Thank you very much.
And she said, as you walk out, she sort of walk away. She says, and don't forget Thursday 9 o'clock for your 20K. And she almost like grins. And carries on stacking papers.
Studley's walking out, and as he's walking out, he's going to turn to Tornado and says, have you ever noticed that everybody always seems to have a bad attitude when we ask them questions?
Well, that's, and then when we ask them for money as well.
I think it must be us.
Well, or maybe you're not asking the right questions to the right people.
We should probably go and check out Bert's place then, above the deli.
So it's a few minutes away, is this?
Sid's giving you the location and via comlinks, and it's literally about a 2 minute walk down the road.
Okay, so we'll probably leave the vehicle parked outside the gym.
Okay.
And and actually walk the way that Sid would have walked back, you know, walked that way, just to see whether or not there's anything out of the ordinary on the streets.
What particularly are you looking out for?
I don't know. Dead bodies, broken window, you know, sort of like smashed.
Okay,
smashed,
so as you walk the two minutes, you don't need to make a perception check for that. There's no dead bodies lying on the street or anything. Bert's not sort of like in a corner dead or anything like that. There doesn't seem to be any. I mean, it's a typical street in Southside. You know, there's probably piles of garbage or refuges all over the place. There's a normal sort of people walking by, cyberpunk guy, gang members, etc. There's the typical people trying to go around earning an everyday living. There's that almost like that stagnant smell of diesel fumes and sort of like probably rotting food in dumpsters, etc. But apart from that, it just seems to be like a normal everyday.
No place is cordoned off with police tape or anything
no,
like that.
No. I mean,
recent murder or.
No, nothing like that at all.
Okay.
That's a shame.
So we're going to head down towards this this delicatessen.
Yeah, so there's this sort of like, it seems to be like a coffee and pastry shop. And there's a little door, so there's sort of like the main sort of like entrance. And there's a little side door off to one side, which has a madlock on it, which is obviously the entrance to their apartment.
Okay, and are there any alleyways down the side of it, or is it adjacent to...
No, it's just sort of like a long line of shops.
Okay.
And it looks like most of them have some kind of over the shop apartment or some description.
Mm-hmm.
Shall we try the doorbell first, in case one of the other fighters are in? Failing that, lock... could always try and get into the door.
So as you're sort of like stood there at the apartment entrance, somebody from inside the coffee, the soya cafe and pastry sort of like comes out and they sort of like dumps a bag of sort of like refuse and rubbish on the pavement. And then as he walks back in, he's just sort of like a human. He seems to have some kind of almost like chef's outfit on, and as he comes back in, he sort of like sees you, all four of you sort of like huddled around the door, and he just says to you, he just sort of like looks, shouts at you and says, they're at the gym, they're not in.
Yes, thank you.
And he sort of like goes back in, and you know, there's people coming and going, walking down the street, walking past you, etc. So it's not a deserted street. It seems to be quite busy, yeah.
So Studley's going to turn onto Locke and say, yes, that's probably a good idea. And then Studley's going to go into the shop.
Okay.
And is there any opening times on the... Or is there an arrow showing the opening times of the...
Of the shop?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Would it have been open when the gym closed?
Well, the gym doesn't close. It's almost like one of these... Sid Stadium, do you mean? Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's open all night. It's like 24/7 workout.
Right, you know. Okay.
So, but the pastry shop actually opens at 5 a.m., and closes at 2 p.m. So it almost like does an early morning shift, a brunch sort of like time shift, a bit of lunch, and then it shuts.
Right.
And then it opens again. And, you know,
right, so it probably wouldn't have been open when Bert had left the gym and was going home that night.
Probably not, yeah.
Right, okay. He is going to go in and order some and get some pastries
the most popular one thing. Is cinnamon and raisins,
right? So he'll
both fabricated, of course.
Cool. He'll order five of those, and
so they're about 10 five credits each, so
okay.
Whilst that's happening, Locke will want to try and hack through the lock.
Okay, what's he doing it via Matrix, or is he doing it via lock picking, locksmith?
Matrix.
Okay, so he's going to have to go AR, and then he's going to have to get a mark on the lock, unless he wants to take out his data jack and actually plug it into the lock.
Are there any particular negatives of doing it through the data jack?
I mean, you'd probably be able to have Billy Bob block in the line of sight of when locked. So he'll stand in front of him so that, you know, bypasses can't thing. And it's probably easy.
Well, yes, I think what will happen is that if that's the plan, then there will be a role to see whether or not you can be, because you're on a busy street. You know, so actually trying to break into somebody's house, you know, you can't just sort of like shield it completely, you know. So there will be almost like passers-by will have a perception test, and they would just sort of like say get -2 to the dice roll because of Billy Bob stood there.
Yeah, but he'll DNI into the
Yeah, so the first thing...
into the DNI of it.
Yeah, so Locke sort of like plugs his data jack in, and the first thing he's going to have to do is a hack-on-the-fly test.
Okay.
In order to... It should say on his character sheet. We should have... if you go into his matrix skills and look down, it's all set up, hack-on-the-fly. Hack on the fly logic, hacking two and sleaze. He's got 15 dice for it.
Just make sure that this cyber deck has its deck array done.
It's on 4, 7, 2, 5. So sleaze is his top one at the moment, 7. Yeah.
Okay, that's fine then.
What button do you want to give me the character?
It says hack on the fly. If you just go down the matrix actions, just look for hack on the fly. It's in alphabetical order. Then if you follow it along,
right page,
you need matrix, to be matrix, yeah.
So I've got cyber programs.
No, you scroll down.
Oh, here we go. Okay. I'm going to scroll down far enough. I didn't know this existed. Hack on the fly. Brilliant.
Yeah. So you just need to press the button. And there's no situation modifiers.
Yeah, 2 successes.
Yeah, okay then. So this lock doesn't seem to have any defense at all. It just seems to be a normal lock. So you managed to get a mark on it, and now you need to find the one that says control device.
You need to take them out of hot sim then. You can't be hot sim in AR.
Yeah, so you manage to unlock the door. It quite easily unlocks. It's not a problem at all. It doesn't seem to be have any protection on it at all. He actually will be running silently. So that's, and there's no noise because you're connected to it. So that's cool. Yeah, and he sort of like clicks his data jack in, and he puts a mark on the locking device, and then he controls action, and he unlocks the door for you, and he pulls his data jack out, so it's ready for you to enter.
2 out of 15, and one out of nine. Say,
unlucky dice roller. Okay, so then Lachlan will go in, and Tornado will go in as well.
Yeah, so Billy Bob and Locke will they will keep guard outside. So Tornado and Studley, are you going in?
Yeah, so Studley comes out of the pastry shop and hands the 5 pastries to Billy Bob, and starts heading towards the door, which you can now see that's slightly ajar, and then thinks better of it and walks back to Billy Bob, opens the bag, takes the pastry out, and then hands the bag back to him, and
he will
eat that as he's going. So I take you, so looking through the door, is it just a set of
stairs going upstairs,
going up to a door at the front. So Studley will go up the stairs eating the pastry as he goes, and
when you get up there, there's sort of like a landing, and there's like 3 bedrooms off the landing, and then there's a 4th room that seems to be some kind of kitchenette. And it has like a table for eating off, etc. It's got food. It's quite messy in there. All the doors are open. There's nothing locked, and everything seems to be quite topsy-turvy. You know, nothing seems to be like it's been looked after. But it doesn't look like it's been ransacked. It looks like there's probably 3 orc teenagers probably living here.
Right. Okay.
Tornado will have a look through the bedrooms to see if he can work out which one is Bert's.
Okay.
In which case, Studley will go into the main living room, I presume. And what is there? Is there a table?
It's just like a kitchen side and a table, a quite run down, battered table, you know, and then that's about it.
Okay. Studley wants to switch his perception to the to astral and to see whether or not he can see any electronic devices.
You won't see electronic devices in the astral. You see auras, don't you?
Right.
Yeah. So okay. make you a sensing test.
Well, if I only see auras, would I see an aura of a?
Well, you'll see if anything's lingering there, any emotions that have been lingering. So, for example, it's a bit like, can you remember when you went into the shop after that girl had gone missing? And you saw auras of worry and confusion, etc. Yeah, the whole place seems extremely calm. There's no astral signatures around. It's not as if anybody's, you know, been in and fired a fireball spell or anything like that. Everything seems quite calm and normal in the whole of the apartment. Tornado, you go through going to each room in turn, and you decide that the one must be Bert's only because. Can you just roll a memory check for me?
Yes, there
you
go.
Yeah, only because you remember some of the data feedback that came from the matrix search that people shared with you. And there seems to be a poster in one of them that's obviously is Bert, winning several fights, etc.
Okay, so finding that room, Tornado wants to have a look around. He wants to see if he can see pictures of other friends or names of friends. I'm assuming there's no sign of struggle, so I'm not going to look for it.
Well, the room's messy. The only things that are up on the wall are like, there's literally a bed and some kind of like TRID video screen in here, a TRIDio screen. And then there seems to be empty soy calf cups all over the place. And there also seems to be some kind of wardrobe cabinet sort of like thing that you assume is for clothes. And then that's about it. It's a very sort of like primitive setup.
Okay. So he'll have a look under the bed. He'll have a look in the wardrobe to see if he can find any data slates or information that way, that electronic information that might have letters or diaries or comlink, that sort of thing.
Okay, so there's no comlink, there's no data pad, there's nothing underneath the bed apart from a whole load of smelly sort of like sports gear, and that's about it, the odd sock, etc. There's a variety of like sports bags that you think they might use to sort of like cart backwards and forwards from the gym. And in the wardrobe, there's a whole load of clothes. There's a whole load of what appears to be some kind of training clothes. So there's things like shorts and sort of like vest tops, etc. And then there's a couple of sort of like suits in there as well, hung up, and they still have their plastic covering over them, you know, to sort of like protect them, and they're just sort of like pushed over to one side.
Okay, well, we'll have a look through the pockets of the suits, because you know there might be a business card or some sort of hint in there.
See, yeah, you said that there's nothing in the pockets or anything like that. There seems to be two suits of orc size.
Are the Studley's going to finish off having a look in the main living room, and then he's going to come into
the kitchen,
where,
yeah.
Yeah, well, yeah, kitchen stroke living room, I suppose, and if there's only bedrooms, and then he's going to come into
he's going to come into the room where Tornado is, and he's, have you found anything of interest?
I've found a few things, but nothing of interest.
Oh, right. Have we got to leave the bed, I take it?
Yeah, he's got sort of, I was just about to go through the sports bags, but he's got a few sports bags and things over there with some with gym kit in and that sort of thing, but I was about to double check through them.
Right. Well, shall any,
lights them out from under the bed and starts unzipping them.
Yeah, the gym kit bags are sort of like all over the place, and they literally seem to be holding things like gym kit. You know, it seems to be something that he probably throws everything into just before he goes off for a training session.
Right. Oh, that's interesting. There's some suits in the wardrobe.
Yeah, I've been through the pockets. There's nothing in there.
Are they new?
Me.
I don't know. I don't know much about suits.
Are these suits both the same fit? Are they identical suits, or are they different colours?
One's a sort of like light grey suit. It's got a matching shirt and tie with it, and the other one's like a navy blue with matching shirt and tie. And they look like they're posh suits. They're a bit like the ones that you had to buy to go on a run when you had to go to a nightclub, I think. If you remember when you were on at Eastside that time.
Can we tell if they've got like a custom named tailor in there, or are they just run of the mill off the shelf suits?
Well, they don't have a tailor's name on it or anything. I mean, they don't look like they're fancy suits, i.e. bespoke. But they do look like they're nice suits. Most definitely.
Okay, so going from that room into the other two bedrooms that are in them, is there anything that says who they might belong to?
Yeah, what the
is there any paperwork or anything?
Well,
or
you can sort of like gather from the posters on the wall. One seems to be somebody called Jack, but it's just J-A-K. Okay, that's Jack, and then the other one appears to be somebody called Daft, and it's D-A-F-T.
And they're both orcs.
Well, Jack seems to, with the K, seems to be a orc. Daft seems to be more of a troll. He seems to be a little bit bigger. And everything's bigger in there. And you also notice that Daft has got like inverted speech marks around the name. So it's obviously some kind of slang or sort of like nickname that people have given him.
Okay. And looking in their wardrobes, are there any high grade suits in their wardrobes?
No. None at all.
Okay.
But there's no sort of slight obvious floorboards that are raised that could have hidden compartments in or that sort of thing.
No, I mean, you could spend some time checking if you wish. You have to do like the knock test.
Yeah. So Tornado will do that.
Okay. So you're checking all four rooms, hitting on the floor in all four rooms.
Studley's not going to check. Studley's going to go
mainly in Bert's room, but not everywhere. So he might try the corners, or if he thinks there's, it's not every square inch of the floor or the walls, but sort of anywhere that he thinks might have one. So he might check, the base of the wardrobe.
Okay, so where are the places that you want to check? Base of wardrobe.
base of the wardrobe, the corners of the room, maybe the middle of the room, anywhere that.
Okay, so base of wardrobe, corners, and middle. I don't think there's much of the room left now.
Well, so he's not going to check. He's just like knocking it. He's looking to see if there's a hollow ring underneath the floorboard.
Yeah. So are you moving the bed? Because the bed's up in one sort of like corner.
No.
Right. Okay. So you go around sort of like banging on the floor, trying to see if there's any sort of like hollow gaps, and you sort of like spend a good 10 minutes or so banging away, and you think it's all absolutely sturdy floorboards. Close to the time when you're finishing banging, you do hear sort of like a shout from down below. That somebody shouts up and sort of like says, "Stop that banging," you know, and obviously from somebody down below, maybe the owner of the shop. But apart from that, you don't find any secret compartments underneath floorboards or any hollow sounding places.
Okay. So Tornado will go back and find Stubbins and say, had a quick look in Bert's room to see if there was, you know, sort of like any hidden compartments or that sort of thing, you know. Couldn't see anything though.
Oh, yes, I didn't think you would.
Well, he might have had a hidden place that he put, you know.
So what do you think we should be doing next?
Well, we should probably go and see if we can chat to Jack and Daft to see if they've seen him recently. That probably seems like the most sensible place to start.
Yes, well, especially seeing it's the only lead that we currently have, I think that is probably a good plan.
Yeah, considering they live with him, they might know a little bit more, about him than Sid.
Excellent. So is the plan to go back to Sid's stadium or to wait here? You re-locking the door as you leave? What's going to be the plan?
So we'll leave the apartment as we the three bedrooms and the kitchen and how we found it. We'll lock the door down at the bottom and then we'll head back to the apartment.
Yeah,
your apartment. Yeah.
Sorry, we'll head back to the stadium.
Okay then. Right. So it's 8:30. So I think we'll take the first break there. And then, so if you are busy watching the stream, then we are going to have a quick 10-minute break. So go and get a drink and grab some food, etc. And we will be back in 10. Okay, so we are back. Quick break there, and the party is going to continue on and try to get the job finished by Thursday at 10 o'clock. So they've been and got the job, the runners, and they have to locate and bring back the Sid Gambetti's prize fighter, Bert the Basher. They've had a chat with the manager, Sid, and his secretary, and then they went off and broke into the apartment where Bert lives, and didn't find anything. There was no secret doors or secret compartments underneath the floor or anything like that. There was no unusual kind of auras or through a sensing. The only interesting thing that they found that was that there was two suits in Bert the Basher's wardrobe that was covered up. They also did find out, however, that the apartment is shared by two people, which is Jack, which is J-A-K, and Daft. And Daft is inverting commas, so they assume that that's some kind of nickname. And I think just before the break, you said that you were heading back to Sid Stadium, yeah?
Yeah, we were going to head back there to see if we could try and track down Jake and Daft.
Cool. Okay then.
Were there posters in there and the walls, like fighting pictures or anything like that?
Pictures of what?
Of them, you know, posing, fighting, holding.
Yeah, that's where you got the their names from.
Right.
In the bedrooms, yeah.
Okay.
So we'd stand a half-decent chance of going in there and recognising them.
Oh, yes. Yeah, most easily.
So the plan is to go back then to Sid Stadium. Mm. And we'll go in and we'll see whether or not we can see them.
Yeah, well, so you arrive, and as you walk through the door, Sid sort of like is still sort of like leaning on the fighter's rope, and he sort of like sees you all coming in, and he sort of says, "Wow, back already? That is well worth it. Let me get your money."
Studley's going to go up to him and say, "We wondered whether or not we could have a word with his." With Bert's housemate, I believe Jack and Daft are there.
He says, I thought you finished the job already. He says, they're over there. And he points to a troll and an orc that are sort of like working out on the bench presses and things like that, and sort of like, you know, skipping, etc.
Okay. Studley will approach the first one, the one that's skipping probably, and he'll go up and he'll clear his throat, he'll cough and say, my name is Stanley, Stanley Lovely. I wondered whether or not I could ask you a few questions.
He sort of like stops skipping, and he sort of like picks up a water bottle and seems to drink some water, and he sort of like asks you whether or not you're from the whether or not you're from Network 7 and you want to do an article on him being a prize fighter.
No, I'm not from Network 7, unfortunately. Although I do hear that the career opportunities with them are very good, especially for a journalist of my stature. I was wondering whether or not I could maybe ask you some questions about one of your roommates, flatmates, Bam Burt.
He seems quite approachable and willing to answer questions. Yeah.
When did you last see Bert?
Both of them sort of like corroborate the story that Bert came back to the apartment after training on Friday. He got, as they put it, he got dressed up smart. and went out.
Oh, did he say whereabouts he was going?
Yeah, well, they sort of like get quite disgruntled about that. Not with you, but it seems that something's happening. And one of the one of them sort of like says, "Oh, well, he never comes to our place anymore. He's obviously got better things to do." You get to know that the fighters seem to frequent a local bar that is called the Scaredy Cat Elf. And that's the name of the bar. And it's where they sort of like hang out a lot. But they were saying that, you know, Bert, first of all, sort of like used to come out a lot with them and to this Scaredy Cat Elf. But over the past few months, he's been training, doing his fights, but then not coming out. And then he sort of like started to buy suits, and he sort of like comes in and he puts his suit on and he sort of like heads off somewhere. Then that's it. You know, he then comes back early morning and then goes in for training, etc.
Did he ever mention where he was?
Yeah, and they sort of like say no, and they didn't ask because they were quite sort of like put out that he's not hanging with them anymore, you know. And they say things like he's obviously got better things than the Scaredy Cat Elf to go to now. And he, you know, that one of them says, you know, he shouldn't be buying those sorts of suits, and you know it must be nice that he can afford things like that, and etc. They seem, if anything, they seem rather disgruntled. And when you sort of like say, you know, about the fight and things like that, they almost like say, it's almost as if they're saying like good riddance to him. They're not concerned at all that he's not there. They almost like feel that he's almost like done them an injustice, you know, and sort of like deserted them.
Stunner's going to say, has anybody ever come round to see him? Lady friend or
he doesn't say any lady friends. The only people who seem to come round to see him are like talent scouts. And a lot of them try to convince Sid to sell them onto him, onto these talent scouts. But Sid obviously knows when he's got a good thing going, you know, and the answer's always no. And Bert does work extremely hard at the gym, you know.
What about moonlighting? Do any of you do any sort of like extra jobs, security or... Like
no, they all like, seem to be completely committed to fighting because, I mean, once you finish your circuit, then the prize money would outdo any sort of security job at all.
But what about before you get that? Because I think Sid mentioned that you don't get your prize money to your last fight. So do you guys have enough, you know, sort of money to...
Yeah, well, they get a weekly allowance. And their apartment is free to live in, and they get to use the facilities here free of charge. You know, so they get enough money to go and have a drink at the weekend, and that's about it. You know, but they're not fussed about that because that's what they're into. You know, they want to be fighters, you know, so they're prepared to sort of like take the low life because eventually they'll be getting a huge amount of money. And hopefully be able to get there without taking any injury that is too serious.
Tornado will also ask them, he'll say, what about enemies or anybody with particular grudges against him, you know, on or off the circuit?
Well, yeah, like what Sid said to you, I mean, all the fighters have people who don't like them because that's part of the fighting circuit. You know, people who are doing well have a lot of enemies. But Daft sort of like laughs at it and he says, well, he hasn't had any hate mail, if that's what you're asking. And nobody's taken a sniper shot at him, you know, or anything like that.
Thank you. That's good to know that he hasn't had any hate mail. What about the opposite? Has he had any excessive fan mail?
Everybody does like I was saying in the first in the description, most people follow me feeds, so there's everybody sort of like done on that, you know, and they sort of like interact on there.
So when he goes wherever he goes wearing his fancy suit, does he walk to the tube station? Does he hire a cab, or
he just says that he gets a cab to take him somewhere.
Right. Okay. Well, thank you very much for answering our questions, and
they get back to working out and training like the rest of the fighters in the fighting gym in Sid's stadium.
Cool. I think Longshanks is writing some. I think he's coming up with an idea.
Longshanks is writing something. Longshanks writing notes from what's just been said. So he goes somewhere in his fancy suits most nights, if not every night, after training, and he gets in a taxi. So perhaps we could try the taxi firm, see if he goes there regularly, you know, uses a particular driver regularly, or if we can find out what routes, or we could ask Locke to have a look through to see if he can find anything out from the taxi firm.
To see where he goes.
Yeah, because surely so that they'll know how long the car's been hired for and where it's gone for safety purposes, if you know if nothing else, for the driver.
I'm not with you on that bit. Where his car's gone?
Well, yeah, I mean the taxi firm's going to know where they've picked him up from and dropped him off.
Right. Okay.
You would have thought, a taxi firm will keep track of its locations of its taxis at all times.
Okay. So how are we going to go about it?
Well, what would have to happen is that Locke would actually have to hack into the taxi firm host and actually try to number one, because you know the name of the taxi host. In Southside, in any case, don't you?
It's Bluefin, isn't it?
Yeah. So he'll have to hack into Bluefin, and then try to search within there to find the data, and to see whether or not he can locate where the pickups happened. If he just sort of like hails a taxi from the street, then it's probably not registered as such, because it'll just be passing trade. But it's something that Locke can try and get if you wish.
Yeah, I think we're going to have to go down that route, because
it's the only lead we have at the moment.
Right. You do have another lead. You know that he takes a taxi somewhere, but the other lead that you have is that you know that a lot of the fighters frequent the scaredy cat elf that Bert used to frequent, but then for some reason doesn't go there anymore. So it could be that you could actually get Locke to spend some time on the Matrix, and he can stay, and Billy Bob can watch his body, you know, his meat body as he goes virtually. And then you guys, Tornado and Studley, you can head off to the Scaredy Cat Elf and see whether or not there's any information that you can find out there.
Right. Okay.
Sounds like a plan. So Locke will probably head back to the van, and Tornado would have given everyone, because I'm assuming it's on like a SYN access for the van. So rather than a key, you know, with a key fob, that if you've got SYN access, SYN access, then you can, you know, it sort of unlocks the car and you can get in. So he would have made sure that everyone in the group has that, so they can get in the van. They can't necessarily drive the van, but they can at least get in the van.
Okay, so
Mark can go back in and sit in the van, so he's not, his body's not lying in the street.
Yeah. Okay, so is the Locke also does for you, since you, he actually does a matrix search for you, and he actually searches for the scaredy cat elf to see what it is, and he comes up with that, you know, it's a popular place for sports fans, and it seems to be where a lot of people go over the weekends and on the sports nights, and they watch things like the combat biking and the urban brawl. It has a really interesting sort of like setup, because it does make a lot of money. It doesn't charge entrance, and it is a bar. However, it only actually serves one kind of beer, which is Sawyerweiser, and it actually comes in bottles, and there's no glasses or even straws or anything like that. And it does serve food, and it just serves one sort of soya burger as well. So it's just sort of like when you arrive, there's literally two things you can have, a Sawyerweiser and a soya burger. And that's literally it. However, one of the advantages is that there is a whole range of sauces that you can put on it in order to sort of like reduce the taste. If the soy burgers actually had a taste. So you can probably add what you want, from chili sauce to mustard and things like that. And around the scaredy cat elf, there's these huge tridios playing. And they're sort of like, each one of them has a different sport on. So when you arrive, you can see like the urban brawl happening on one screen and combat biking on the other one. And then there's a big sort of like street fight that you recognize as sort of like a street circuit fight going on. And then over in a corner, there's a little room, and there's a much smaller television there. And they seem to be playing the sport soccer. You know, and there's a lot of people rolling around faking leg injuries, you know, and the ice hockey teams, there's another one with ice hockey playing, and they almost look compared to the others, you know, the urban brawl and the combat bikers, they almost look like, they look more like synchronized ice skaters, you know, rather than the more extreme sports that you can see happening. And, you know, as you arrive, there's various people holding their Sawyerweiser bottles, bottle in one hand, burger in the other hand. And every now and again, they cheer up in the air, and Sawyerweiser sort of like spurts out the top. And as their, you know, their least favorite combat biker gets taken out by a spell or a rain of bullets, or the person in the fighting scene sort of like gets knocked out or loses a tooth or a tusk, or, you know, just falls to the ground and that's it. And there's a lot of advertisers and arrows sort of like bursting out at you left, right and center, you know, buy this, bet on this person, bet on these teams, etc. And it's something that you can just tap into your SYNs, you know, via your comlinks, and sort of like do random bets anytime.
And Studley just hates this type of place. It's too noisy, it's too brash. The people who frequent it aren't his type of this place looks more like a sushi bar.
This is what it sort of like looks like, but more with the big screens roundabout.
But yeah, it's too loud for me. It's too brash. There's too much testosterone in the place. It doesn't like the type of people who are in it. It doesn't like sport anyway. So, yes.
So yeah, Tornado would have gone in as well. It's not 100% his thing, but it's not not his thing, if you know what I mean. So
it is, but it isn't.
It is, but it isn't. It's not the sort of place he would choose to frequent. As you said, it's a bit, you know, a bit too sort of like testosterone heavy for a night out for him. But he's not bothered by it as he goes in.
How's going up to the bar? How does it look like the serving's done?
It just seems to be a whole load of men and women, ranging from human, elf. There's quite a mix of metahumans in this place, and it's literally you buy soy wise. There's obviously a kitchen in the back that is actually producing the soya burgers, probably bought in mass frozen amounts, and then just sort of like shoved onto a grill, probably not even defrosted or anything like that, and then just sort of like churned out. And you actually, what seems to be happening is that people just are getting a bottle and a burger, and a lot of the arrows above the things that says bottle and burger, you know, speciality for today, bottle and burger. And they just seem to have this burger that comes in like what can only be classed as a soggy napkin, as like a serviette, and they just sort of like open the bun, pop the burger in. And then there's a huge bar that has a whole load of like all the sauces, all the chili sauces, and they just seem to be going over and sort of like squeezing huge amounts of like curry sauce or chili sauce or barbecue sauce onto these burgers, and then biting into them and all the sauces going everywhere, and then they swill it down with soyweiser straight from the bottle. The bar people behind sort of like detach the cap just by sort of like knocking it on the side of the counter, and then they literally are handing over soyweisers and burgers, and that's it.
So how busy is the place at the moment?
Oh, really busy. There's quite a few, you know, there's a constant movement around the place, and they seem to be, people are congregated around various trid screens, you know, watching their favourite sports. It looks like the sort of like bar would make a huge amount of money.
Right, well, I suppose... We should try and talk to some regulars or one of the bar people, to see if they've seen him recently.
I don't know who the regulars are, to be honest with you. It is the first time I've been in here. We could try talking to a barman, but they do look very busy.
Yeah. I mean, maybe the barman might be able to say who he used to hang around with and point us out to them if they're here.
Do you want to try to have a go at attracting one of the servers at the bar, or do you just think they're too busy, so just leave it?
The servers as well?
Well, yeah, there's lots of people sort of like taking people's orders and coming out and at the bar, sort of like. So it's one of those places when it's several rows deep and people are just sort of like ordering over the heads, you know, and the people behind the bar just grabbing the Budweisers and burgers. The burgers come through a hatch behind them, and they just sort of like, they don't even shout five burgers or anything like that. The burgers are just continually being produced. And sort of like popped on a rack, and they're just coming up and taking them and giving them out a bottle and burger at a time.
Is there any seating at the bar, or?
Yeah, there is this long table down the middle. It does look like there was supposed to be seating at the bar, but the chairs are all sort of like pushed in because there's a whole crowd of people sort of like. And buying stuff, and then going off and watching the tridios. They tend to eat a burger and drink a drink, and then go back and eat a burger and drink a drink, and so forth and so on.
Okay, so Studley's going to position himself on one of these chairs.
Okay,
and do serving people come out?
Well, there doesn't seem to be any waitresses or anything around, if that's what you're saying. It all seems, it's a bit like a bar. So right. Everything's being organized. I mean, there are people sat on these chairs, eating and drinking and sort of like watching the sports going on the Tridios.
Right. So you go up to this area and order what you want then.
Exactly.
And then it comes out and then you just do whatever.
Yeah. Then you watch your favorite sport. There's the arrows so you can put bets on. And that's it seems to be a popular sports bar.
Are there any posters of the Basher?
All the walls are just like huge Tridio screens.
Okay, so the screens. Okay, that's
right. Yeah.
Does it have any adverts for upcoming fights? For example, Bert's fight or.
Yeah, well, I mean, they're not on the screens, but on your arrows, there's a lot of spam that's talking about Bert the Bashers against Snapper Saul is up. You know, there's very adverts on that, and you can place bets on that, you know, and it sort of like gives Bert's successful ratings over X amounts of months. And you know that this is going to be his last fight, so don't miss the opportunity to put a bet down, you know. And then there's the fight that's going on the screen and who's that's between, and you can make real life bets, and you can make bets on who's going to be the surviving member of the combat biker bit and everything like that.
Right, okay.
Right, so Studley's going to go up to the going to go up to the bar. As I say, he's not pleased in this type of place, but he's going to go up.
Okay, cool. What would you like to do?
I'd like to order a bottle of soy rister and
somebody comes up to you and they don't even seem to ask you what you want. You're just sort of like, you get there and you sort of like make your way, you know, through the crowd, and you don't actually push your way through. You're almost like moved with the crowd. So as the people from the front move out, you just get closer and closer and closer. And then all of a sudden you sort of like find yourself there, and this sort of like a human female sort of like puts in front of you the burger and the Budweiser sort of like holds out like a scanner that you recognize as sort of like cash collectors, you know, that they then scan your comm link and that sort of like deducts the money from it.
Okay. So when he's placing his order, he'll say, I wonder whether or not you could help me with some more information. I don't know whether or not you have a break shortly. I'm writing a piece, an article on one of the.
She looks almost like she almost like looks impatient now, you know, because she's sort of like holding these two things out, and she sort of like looks at you and says, "Sin, comlink."
Yeah, he'll do that.
Yeah, and she sort of like scans it, and she sort of like goes off to sort of like pay another customer.
All right. Okay, and Studley will take his drink and his burger and he'll go and sit down.
Okay.
Eat it, then go out.
Okay, then. So you eat your burger and you drink your soy wiser, and then you head on out.
Yeah.
Okay. Seeing that, Tornado will try and approach the bar very quickly, and when he gets to the front of the bar, he'll say, "Looking for Bert. Bert the Basher. Have you seen him recently? He used to come in here as he's paying. So whoever."
Yeah, you almost like get the same reaction, you know, and they just sort of like they seem to be really busy serving, you know, and sort of like. Trying to get as much food out as possible. She just sort of like wants to scan your card, your comm link. And okay. There's people behind you sort of like humming and hawing, you know, because they want to get their Budweiser, their Sawyerweiser.
Okay. He'll take the saw, he'll pay, and then if she hasn't responded, he'll walk out, leaving the Sawyerweiser, and he'll leave the Sawyerweiser on the table and in the center, and he'll walk out with the burger.
Cool. Okay, I think that would be a good place to leave it for tonight, and then we can continue playing it next week. So does anybody have any announcements that they would like to make at the end of the stream?
No announcements.
Nope. Cool. So I will be back on Thursday, probably playing some Elder Scrolls Online, and then, or maybe making up a new D&D 5th edition character, because I got one more to make. And then on Saturday at 3 o'clock, and at 3 o'clock we will be playing I will be playing ESO, and then at 7 o'clock we'll be playing Mithras on this channel, and then on Sunday I'll be playing Elder Scrolls Online again. So thank you for turning out today. I really do appreciate you coming and supporting the stream. Hopefully we might have almost a full complement next week, but we'll be able to see what happens to the party and whether or not they manage to find Bert the Basher in time for Thursday, which will be the when they get their full amount. So thank you very much for coming along. I really do appreciate you coming out to the stream. And I'd just like to say to you, each and every one of you, before you leave, please remember to be who you are and say what you think, because the people who mind don't matter, and the people who matter don't mind. Have fun, and I will catch you all later. And until then, consider yourself waffled.